Hello everyone, and welcome again to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Saba, and today we're going to discuss the Anderson-Darling test, another very handy test from mathematical statistics to determine whether our beliefs about the distribution of a particular series is true. In one of the previous videos, we studied the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. Anderson-Darling test is less common, less well-known than the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, but it has one interesting property. Unlike Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, the Anderson-Darling test is concerned with the tails of the distribution rather than the peak of the distribution. And that's something that we can be more concerned with in finance in particular. For example, in risk management, when we try to figure out which distribution is the best to model something like value at risk. Naturally, in value at risk, we are concerned with the extreme events, the extreme, most significant losses that occur on the left tail of our portfolio's return distribution. So, for these purposes, Anderson-Darling test can actually be more applicable. Without further ado, let's apply Anderson-Darling test to S&P 500 returns and figure out whether the tails of the distribution primarily follow the normality assumption. And I can't stress this enough. Those tests, Anderson-Darling, Kolmogorov-Smirnov, are not reserved only for checking normality. If you have other beliefs that can be reasonably justified with theory or common sense about the distribution, then you could apply them for any other theoretical distribution rather than normal. But again, normal distribution is one of the most commonly used in day-to-day financial practice in economics, econometrics. So as for now, we're going to stick with that, but later on, if you're interested, we can discuss some other famous distributions that can match return data in particular with greater precision. But now, let's move on to our spreadsheet. And again, just as with Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, we have 5 years worth of S&P 500 return data. And the first thing we need to do is we need to determine the number of observations, which is just counting our trading days, again, 1,258. We need to calculate our sample mean, which is just the average of our observations, and our sample standard deviation, which is STDEV.S, so sample formula for standard deviation of the whole series. Next, we need to sort our returns. To do that, we just need to copy them and paste as values in a different column. Select the return array and apply the sort function in Excel under the data tab. So sort, continue with the current selection, sort values smallest to largest. That's exactly what we need. And now we can assign ranks to our observations, and as our observations are already sorted smallest to largest, then the smallest observation will have a rank of 1, the next will have a rank of 2, and so on and so forth. So we can just select those two, bottom right click it all the way down, and naturally our highest positive return will have a rank of 1,258, so the total number of observations. Now we need to calculate our empirical distribution function, and again, just as usual, it is the rank divided by the total number of observations, and we log the number of observations naturally, and we bottom right click it all the way down, and we get the empirical distribution function for the whole series. Now we're concerned with the theoretical distribution, and just as last time, we need to calculate the normal cumulative distribution function for the observed value of our return given sample, mean, and standard deviation. So we just apply the norm dist function. Our x is our observed return. Our mean is the sample mean, and we lock that. Our standard deviation is the sample standard deviation, and we lock that too. And we need the cumulative distribution function, not the probability density function, so we put 1. And we can apply it for the whole series as well. But for Anderson-Darling test, there is a twist. Unlike in Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, when we just have the theoretical distribution and that's it, for Anderson-Darling test, to capture the goodness of fit at the tails in particular, we need to calculate the reverse theoretical distribution. So for the smallest observation, we need both the theoretical distribution for this observation in particular and for the highest observation. For the second lowest observation, we need the theoretical distribution for it and for the second highest, and so on and so forth. So we need the theoretical distribution and the reverse theoretical distribution. To do that, we can apply the large function in Excel. The large function in Excel gives you the nth highest element at a particular series. So let me show you how to apply it. So we apply large function, select the whole array, we lock it, and we need nth largest element in this array. So if we apply it like that and bottom right click it all the way down, we'll get the corresponding reverse theoretical distribution function. Why do we need that? Well, Anderson-Darling test is tricky as it has a number of steps that you need to undertake before you can arrive at hypothesis testing. We need to calculate the so-called S function, which is weighted difference between theoretical distribution and the reverse theoretical distribution. So, to apply this formula, which is presented over here, we need to divide 2 times the rank minus 1 divided by the total number of observations that we again need to lock, and we need to multiply it by the sum of the natural logarithm of our theoretical distribution plus the natural logarithm of 1 minus our reverse theoretical distribution. And this procedure that we incorporated in the formula over here allows us to determine how well does the theoretical distribution fit the empirical distribution, particularly in the tails. So, without further ado, we can enforce this formula, bottom right click it all the way down, and calculate the S as the sum of this function across all observations. So we sum all of the observations and we get slightly below negative 1300. The Anderson-Darling statistic is the square root of minus n minus s. So we can calculate the square of the Anderson-Darling statistic by subtracting our s from minus n. And we get that the Anderson-Darling statistic squared is around 20. And the statistic itself is just the square root of its square, and it's around 4.47. Then, from the observed value of Anderson-Darling statistics, as in pretty much all hypothesis testing, we can extract the p-value. So the probability that this deviation from the theoretical distribution, particularly at the tails, can be attributable to random chance. The transition from Anderson-Darling statistic to p-value is not straightforward, I'm afraid to say. But let's tackle that. For different thresholds of Anderson-Darling statistics, there are different numerical approximations of the p-value. In particular, if our Anderson-Darling statistic is greater or equal to 0.6, our formula is just the exponent of the square function of the statistic. So first, we need to figure out the value of this quadratic function of the Anderson-Darling statistic, and then, taking the exponent of it, we can calculate our p-value. So the exponent will be equal to 1.294 plus minus 5.709 times the Anderson-Darling statistic plus 0.019 times the Anderson-Darling statistic squared. And now we can take the exponent of the value of this function and we can get our p-value, which is very, very close to zero. So for our case, when our Anderson-Darling statistic is 4.47, which is greater or equal to 0.6, we can state with certainty that our p-value is approximately zero, and it means that there is no reasonable chance that such a deviation from the normal distribution at the tails can be explained by random chance. And again, just as with Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, it is quite significant evidence for the non-normality of the return distribution for S&P 500. But what can we do if our Anderson-Darling statistic is smaller than 0.6? Well, for other thresholds, there are other quadratic functions that approximate the p-value the best. And the coefficients of these quadratic functions are written in this table. So we can drag this formula of the exponent, the value of the quadratic function, then we take the exponent of to get the p-value. We can drag this around and we'll get the value of the exponent. For Anderson-Darling statistic greater or equal to 0.34 and less than 0.6, we can still just take the exponent of the quadratic function and get the p-value. For other two cases, when the statistic is less than 0.34, we need to take 1 and subtract the exponent. So these are four most common cases for observed values of Anderson-Darling statistic. If, on the other hand, Anderson-Darling statistic is very, very high, if it's greater than 153.4, we can straightforwardly just state that the p-value is equal to zero. And this was the Anderson-Darling test. Another neat way to estimate whether our empirical distribution follows any particular theoretical distribution, with an emphasis on the tails. And we got some more overwhelming evidence that the returns of most commonly used American benchmark S&P 500 are not normally distributed, so assuming normal distribution for your value at risk or for your portfolio optimization or whatever it might be is probably not that great of an idea. Stay tuned. Please remember to subscribe to our channel, leave a like under this video if you found it helpful, and please state in the comments any other topics in business, economics, or finance that you want to see videos on in the future. Thank you very much, and goodbye.